Good morning. Today is March the 6th, Tuesday. Hope that you're doing well today. Go ahead and open your Bibles with me to Matthew chapter number 5. And we're going to pick up in our study on what is commonly called the Sermon on the Mount. So Matthew chapter 5, we took a little bit of a detour, talked about suffering and bad things happening in our lives. I'm not convinced that I'm completely done with that. I do want to get, for the moment, back into the book of Matthew. The last thing that we covered was Matthew chapter 5, verse number 10. Blessed are they which are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are ye when men shall revile you and persecute you, and shall say all manner of evil against you falsely, for my name's sake. Rejoice and be exceedingly glad, for great is your reward in heaven, for so persecuted they the prophets which were before you. We spent quite a bit of time talking about the reality that as Christians, we are persecuted for righteousness' sake. Those who live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution, the Bible says. We are not above our master. Our master was persecuted. Our master suffered. Bad things happened to our master. He was crucified, and we are his disciples. We are his followers. And any teaching that says otherwise is wrong. It is not what the Bible teaches. And if you look in church history, Christians have suffered from the very beginning. When the way Christianity was introduced, they were persecuted at the hands of the Judaizers, of their brothers, the fellow Jews. They were also persecuted tremendously at the hands of the imperial authority or the government. So Christians have always suffered, and there's no way around that. They'll continue to suffer. So let's go ahead and get into verse number 13. Ye are the salt of the earth, but if the salt have lost its savor, wherewith shall it be salted? It is thenceforth good for nothing but to be cast out and to be trodden under the foot of men. In this verse, we clearly see the need for contextual interpretation before we can attempt to make an application. A lot of people get in trouble is because when they read the Bible, they do not attempt to interpret the Bible, but immediately jump to application. There can be no application without an accurate interpretation. The interpretation, or the hermeneutic, or whatever, is the what, who said it, who did they say it to, what was the context, what was the culture in which it was spoken. I hear people say, well, that's your interpretation. Well, the Bible says that no portion of Scripture is subject to private interpretation. It means exactly what it means, okay? It means what it meant when it was said. And that's what we want to see. There's not double meaning at all. It's not subject to private interpretation, okay? What we have to do is seek out the accurate interpretation, what the audience heard as the speaker spoke. It meant something to them, and we need to figure that out, okay, before we can attempt to make an accurate application how it applies to our lives today. So let's look at the interpretation first of this verse. Now, many will say that this verse applies to Christians. However, this verse does not apply to the church specifically, as that it has specific application to the house of Israel. You need to remember something. When the Gospels were written, there was no church, okay? The testator had not died. Christ, the new covenant, had not been put into place. Actually, the Gospels are the end of the Old Testament. The Gospels are the end of the Old Testament. So, he is not talking to the church. He is talking to the Jews. Sure, there's application that can be made to the church, but that's only after an accurate interpretation has been rendered. Okay? When teachers apply this verse to Christians, they say things like, salt keeps meat from corrupting. So when we preach the gospel, we keep the world from corrupting. Well, in reality, I don't see that. We have been preaching the gospel for centuries, and the world is just as corrupt as it has always been, or worse, okay? They go on and say, well, salt cleanses, thus we have, the church has the cleansing effect on the world. Well, again, I don't see that. I haven't seen that in my lifetime. I didn't watch the Oscars, okay? But I am pretty sure that wasn't very clean. On the contrary, the world has crept into the church for the most part, and much of the organized church is defiled by the world. So again, to jump to that application, though I'm not going to deny that there's some partial application there, but it's not totally true. There's not this preservation or this salt and purity thing happening within the church. Again, I just don't see that. I don't see that as the primary application, let alone interpretation. Again, we must keep in the forefront of our minds that this passage is in the Sermon on the Mount, or what is commonly referred to as the giving of the law. Okay, it was preached to Jewish disciples about a Jewish kingdom, okay, a literal, visible kingdom on this earth in which the Jews will be the ruling nation over which Jesus will be their king. Now, of course, again, where does the Old Testament end and the New Testament begin? It's not Matthew chapter 1 and verse number 1, okay? It's the cross. The cross initiated the new covenant. The death of the testator is when the new covenant began. In Hebrews 9:16, for where a testament is, there must also of necessity be the death of the testator. Okay? For a testament is of force after men are dead. Otherwise, it is of no strength at all while the testator liveth. New Testament began after the death of Christ, not Matthew chapter number 1. Matthew 26:26, and as they were eating, Jesus took bread and blessed it and broke it and gave it to the disciples and said, take, eat, this is my body. And he took the cup and gave thanks, gave it to them, saying, drink ye all of it, for this is my blood of the New Testament, okay, which is shed for many for the remission of sins. But I say unto you, I will not drink it henceforth of this fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it anew with you in my Father's kingdom. Okay, so the New Testament begins with the death of the testator. And Jesus is clearly saying here in what we call the Lord's Supper, this is my blood of the New Testament. He was looking forward to his blood being shed, so that the new covenant could begin. So why are the Jews called the salt of the earth? I mean, it says clearly here, ye are the salt of the earth. The ye that is being referred to is not the church. Specifically, it is the Jew. Okay, why are the Jews called the salt of the earth? They are the salt of the earth because of God's covenants of salt that were made with them. Okay, there were covenants of salt that God made with the Jews. This is the primary interpretation of what the text is saying. Okay, Numbers 18:19. All the heave offerings of the holy things which the children of Israel offer unto the Lord have I given thee, and thy sons and thy daughters with thee, by a statute forever. It is a covenant of salt forever before the Lord, unto thee and to thy seed with thee. In 2 Chronicles 13:5, ought ye not to know that the Lord God of Israel gave the kingdom over Israel to David forever, even to him and to his sons by a covenant of salt? Okay? As a matter of fact, all of Israel's offerings were accompanied by salt. Leviticus 2:13, and every oblation of thy meat offering shalt thou season with salt, and neither shalt thou suffer the salt of the covenant of thy God to be lacking from thy meat offerings. With all thine offerings thou shalt offer salt. Okay, these covenants were called perpetual because they have no end and they will stand forever. That includes into the millennial reign of Christ. There's a rabbi that said the term covenant of salt is indicative of the everlasting nature of the relationship between the children of salt and their Elohim Yahweh. When we hear the term salt, the understanding is that the things Yahweh addresses are eternal, they are enduring, they are never changing, they are abiding forever. All salt covenants then are eternal and eternally binding on the sons and the daughters of Israel, regardless where they are to be found and regardless of whether a physical temple stands on Mount Moriah or not. Okay, this is a rabbi. I have no idea how to pronounce his name. It's Rabbi Moshe Yosef Kenikowski is the way I'm doing it there, but I'll put my notes up and you can read his name. So we've established that the salt covenants were made with the house of Israel. And when the Lord says, ye are the salt of the earth, he is referring to the house of Israel, and he is throwing back to the salt covenants. Again, we have to come up with the interpretation, what it meant when it was said, before we can start making application. Okay, then you can start jumping into preserving and all those things that we immediately jump into, though I don't think they're necessarily particularly 100% accurate. But then notice what he says, but if the salt have lost its savor. Okay, now, again, the salt he's referring to is the salt covenants, Israel. How does a salt lose its savor? A Christian chemist named Morvant says that Jewish women use salt on meat to preserve it, since they had no refrigeration. Salt has ways of stopping bacteria and fungus by dehydrating the meat. The women would use the salt over and over because it was an expensive commodity. As a matter of fact, back then, the Roman legions were paid in salt. It's where we come up with the phrase, he's not worth his salt, or he's worth his salt, because he was paid with a bag of salt. In the dehydrating process, the salt would take on the impurities of the meat. Okay, the salt would begin to take on the impurities of the meat. The result was that the salt would lose its ability eventually to preserve because its chemical composition would begin to change with the addition of other chemicals from the meat. Okay, so eventually the salt would become corrupted. You see why, when you have that application that we talked about, doesn't exactly lend to be true in the long run. The women could tell when it was no longer good or when it had lost its savor by tasting it. Then it was thrown out because it was good for nothing. So when he says, ye are the salt of the earth, he's referring to Israel, salt covenants, but if the salt loses its savor, wherewith shall it be salted? It is therefore good for nothing. It is of no value anymore, but to be cast out, to be trodden under the foot of men. What does that mean? The women would then take the old salt that had lost its savor and they would throw it around their yards and their pathways to keep the grass from growing. As a matter of fact, armies of old would go into the fields of their enemies and sow them with salt because it would render the land useless. Very similar to the way that we would, the women would use this like we would to de-ice a sidewalk. I mean, if you throw salt down, it's going to kill the grass, what they would use it for. We take salt and throw it down and it actually melts the ice. I've had some opportunities getting ready to leave again to go up to Brownsville, Pennsylvania. I hope it doesn't snow. So I've got to see a lot of de-icing going on with salt. It's thrown out. It's interesting that the same phrase used to describe what they did to their Messiah and what he in return will allow to happen to them. Okay, let me tell you what I'm talking about. Hebrews 10:29, of how much more sore punishment suppose ye shall he be thought worthy who hath trodden underfoot the Son of God? Uses the same phrase there to speak of how they threw him out and trod him underfoot and hath counted the blood of the covenant wherewith he was sanctified a holy thing and hath done despite unto the Spirit of grace. It's interesting, that same phrase, thrown out to be trodden under the foot of men. So what is the application here? How does this apply to the Jews that Jesus is speaking to? They were the salt that he was referring to. However, they were now impure and had lost their savor. They had picked up impurities in their worship of God. Instead of sacrificing to Jehovah God according to the covenants of salt, they had begun to sacrifice to idols. Psalm 106:36, and they served their idols, which were a snare unto them. Yea, they sacrificed their sons and their daughters unto devils, and shed innocent blood, even the blood of their sons and of their daughters, whom they sacrificed unto the idols of Canaan, and the land has been polluted with their blood. Instead of following the priest of Aaron's line, according to the covenant of salt, they followed other priests. 1 Kings 12:28, whereupon the king of Israel took counsel, or the king took counsel and made two calves of gold and said unto them, it is too much for you to go up to Jerusalem. Behold thy gods, O Israel, which brought thee up out of the land of Egypt. They begin to fall into idolatry. Instead of being under King David, under a king from David's line, according to their covenant of salt, they put themselves under tribute to foreign kings. In John 19:15, but they cried out, away with him, away with him, crucify him. Pilate saith unto him, shall I crucify your king? The chief priests answered, we have no king but Caesar. The conclusion is that the Jews had lost their savor and were good for nothing. Jeremiah 13:10, this evil people which refuse to hear my words, which walk in the imaginations of their own heart and walk after other gods to serve them and to worship them, shall even be as this girdle, which is good for nothing but to be cast out. So two things before we get into application for the church. Two things were to happen as a result of the Jews losing their savor. Physically, they were to be cast out of the land physically in 70 AD by the Roman general Titus Vespasian. Just like the salt, they were cast out because they had lost their savor, good for nothing, cast out to be trodden under the foot of men. Spiritually, they were also consequences. They turned their back on their Messiah. They rejected the King of Israel, the one that was promised to come. They rejected him. And as a result, they have entered into a time of spiritual blindness. So that is the primary interpretation of this text. Next time we get together, we'll talk about its application to the church. God bless you guys. I appreciate you watching. I hope that you enjoy this, and I hope that you're blessed by it. I do put the notes up later. I upload this video to YouTube. I actually put it on YouTube channel, then copy it over in a YouTube video to DuaneSpearman.org, and then I post the notes there. And then, of course, I put links on the Facebook page. If I can help you in any way, if I can pray with you, I'd be more than happy to do that. I do appreciate you listening to me. It's my way of ministering to you. I love teaching the Word of God, and I hope you're blessed by it. And remember that God loves you. God wants the best for you, and He's working all things out for your good.